even Paul, our brother Paul, also mentioned in 1 Timothy chapter 6, where it tells us sharing our wealth is a way of laying up treasures in heaven. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 17 to 19. Command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty. That means not to be arrogant or proud, so feel so mighty and strong because of their wealth. Nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who gave us richly all things to enjoy. Let them do good. Let them be rich in good works, ready to give, willing to share, storing up for themselves a good foundation for the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. So Paul tells us that one of the ways to lay up treasure in heaven is we continue to do good, rich in good works, okay, willing to share, ready to give. So we lay up treasure in heaven by living the way that God has asked us to do and follow Him. All that we do. So if we love our neighbor as ourselves, meaning if our neighbor is anyone who needs, we have to help him. We have extra shirts, give him one. Be a cheerful giver. You know, in marriage, honoring God. See, guarding your mind against adulterous thoughts. Sharing the good news of gospel with everyone that we can. If we were to sum all this up, it's like the book of Matthew chapter 22 verse 37 says, okay, love the Lord our God with all your hearts, soul, mind and strength, and loving the neighbor as yourself. When we set our hearts on things of this earth and fall temptation of being worthy in our ways, we are committing idolatry, because we are no longer serving God. Rather, we put riches above God and we are serving them, and then indeed they become our God and our life. So Jesus challenged every one of us, though he was talking on that day with a crowd, challenged us to ask ourselves the questions: where is our treasure? If our treasure is on earth and the things of this world, then our hearts will be there as well. But if our heart is to focus on our Father in heaven and lay up treasures in heaven, then our heart will be there. So where is your treasure? Ask these questions and answer it yourself. Let's continue in the book, Matthew chapter 6, verse 22. The lamp of the body is the eye. If therefore your eye is good, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? In our day-to-day living, as we get influenced by the world, people out there, when we start gathering and storing up riches on earth, we blur our visions. We can't see clearly anymore. Our goal of living, what is our thing that we want to focus on? We blur all our visions. We cannot see clearly anymore. It causes us not to see the truth anymore. Not able to follow God's commandment, because it doesn't seem like logical. So gathering up all these riches from the world will actually blur us. It distorts our vision, causing us not to see God as clearly as it may be initially. Let's turn to the book of Acts chapter 5, verse 1 to 11. Here is the story of Ananias and Sapphira, where they lied to the Holy Spirit. In the story, due to time constraint, I will not read through the entire scripture passage. You can read yourself at Acts chapter 5, verse 1 to 11. But basically, here the story of a man and his wife sold possessions and brought the money to the apostles and and lay their feet, but they did not give the whole sum of the money that they have sold, the property. In the book of Acts chapter 4, Acts chapter 4, verse 34 to 35, why did find Sapphira, at least I find Ananias and Sapphira did it? Because it was actually a common day, common things that member of churches do. In Acts chapter 4, verse 34 to 35, nor was there anyone among them who lacked, for all who were potential of lands and houses sold them and brought the proceeds of things that were sold, verse 35, and laid them at the apostles' feet, and then distributed to each as anyone had need. So that's what Christians do. Sell things that they have and give to the poor. And so this particular couple, Ananias and Sapphira, thinking that they are also doing what all these people are doing, charitable work, sell their land, sell the possession, and give to the poor to help the poor. Of course, it's good. But what happened is this storyteller that they lied. The apostles know that they lied because they did not give all that they have. So they kept half of the money and lied. The very reason is because Ananias and Sapphira wants to get praise from men to say, oh, they are also very spiritual, very good, they also give. Okay? Ananias and Sapphira have seen the praise that other people have been accepted, and that's why they sell the property and so their possessions, but all wrong purpose. For the purpose of being able to be noticed by people, being acceptable by others, and considered as spiritual. And because of this, they lie to the Holy Spirit, and that's why they die. Though they have the good things, but their heart is wrong, they be blurred, they see wrong things, they thought that they are doing something that is supposed to do, but they didn't really do it. And then examples we can find is in the book of Luke chapter 12, the book of Luke chapter 12 verse 13 to 21, we are talking about the parable of the rich fool. Luke chapter 12, if you have a Bible, you can turn with me to Luke chapter 12 verse 13 to 21. Then one of the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Man, who makes me the judge or an arbitrator over you?" And he said to them, "Take heed and beware of covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of the thing he possesses." Verse 16. Then he spoke a parable to them, saying, "The ground of a certain rich man yielded plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, 'What shall I do, since I have no room to store my crops?' So he said, 'I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build greater, and there I will store all my crops and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods laid up for many years. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry.'" Verse 20. "But God said to him, 'Fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Then whose will those things be which you have provided?'" That's the outcome according to Jesus. So it's he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. Jesus made a very profound statement where we all should be carefully listen. Verse 15 says, "One's life," all of us have our own life, "one's life does not consist in the abundance of things he possesses." It doesn't mean that you have a lot of things, it means you are better off than another person. The parable actually tells us that don't be like this fool, okay? Thinking that he can sit down and relax because he has plenty of food. Actually, in our normal life, we already have this similar situation. Many people in career life thinking that, you know, once you reach the age of retirement, 65, oh, plenty of saving, it's enough. Can retire happily. give without any worry. But that's not what God wants us to do. God wants us to be rich towards Him. So don't just sit down and enjoy your fortune, thinking that that's the right way to save up for retirement. When we make riches our focus on our life, our vision will be distorted. When you want to be rich, want to be mighty, want to be strong, want to have a lot of things, you have to love your vision. When things that we seem overweight the eternal things that are unseen, then we are spiritual short-sighted. Jesus said, your eye is important. Indeed, our eye is like a window where the light gets into our eyes and then we can see things. We can see the color, the shape of things. Have you heard from those people who have cataract tells you that after the operation then only that you are so clearly, oh no wonder that's the red color, that's the thing, that's how it looks like. If our eyes have been clouded, not clear, okay, where there is dirt and distorted, lights cannot go in, we see things wrongly. So what here Jesus is trying to tell us that the light that gets into our man, hearts and soul, depends on our spiritual state of our eyes. Our spiritual vision, how we see things spiritually, our capacity to see clearly what God wants us to do and to see the world from God's point of view. That is very important. But easier our eye can be easily clouded. We tend to be influenced by the world out there, so much so that we become self-serving. We serve our own self, our own desire, our own needs, our own interests, and this block the visions. And that's why we cannot move towards kingdom if we follow the world. Let's continue with Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. No one can serve two masters. For either he hates the one and loves the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. By definition, a master means we have to have, we give total loyalty. And we are not able to please two masters at the same time. Many actually thought that we can have the best of both worlds, both here on earth, serving ourselves with riches, living it out, and later on, can be in heaven as well. But Jesus tells us clearly here, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to one and despise the other. So what he means here is, we cannot serve money and God, we cannot serve other things than God. If you want to be popular, you end up not no more in church. You may be doing something so that you can become popular. You are no more serving God. True enough. If you love your family so much that all your family members say, I don't want to go to church, I want to do this, do that. You love your family so much that you serve your family. Not serving God. We can only have one master. And Jesus helps us to change, helps us to repent our mind so that we don't continue to focus it on earthly treasures. We have to serve Him. That is why to be a good servant of our Lord, we have to know the cost. If you turn to the book of Mark chapter 8, Mark chapter 8, verse 34 to 38. Mark chapter 8, verse 34 to 38. It's written, when he had called the people to himself with his disciples also, he said to them, whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself and and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel will save it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my word in this adulterous and sinful generation of him, the Son of Man also will be ashamed when he comes to the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Here we are called to give up ourselves completely and to place complete trust in our Father and follow him. Ask yourself the question, is it easy? That's the cost of discipleship. To be a true follower of our Lord Jesus Christ, we have to deny ourselves. That means our interest, our own desire are not that important. What God commands us to do, his will, is more important. We have our own desire. We may want to do a lot of good things that we thought that actually is good. That's our own. But what God tells us to do, we have to do, and that is have higher priority. We can also take a look at Luke chapter 14, verse 25 to 33. Luke chapter 14, verse 25 to 33. Now great multitudes went with him, and he turned and said to them, if anyone comes to me and does not hear what? Hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and his whole life also, he cannot be my disciple. Very strong commands here. That means, what? Hate your father, mother, wife, children, brother, and sister. Yes, also his own life. You cannot be my disciple. Luke chapter 14, verse 25.